Okay. Hi, everybody. This is Sel of My Wine Life. And today we're going to talk with Luca. He's a sommelier by heart. And he worked for numerous Michelin star restaurants like Gordon Ramsay, Angela Harnett, and the Hilton. He opened a lot of bars like Solo Vino Bar and Art Trader, and is now managing the leading sustainable restaurant Pier Chic in Dubai. So, Luca, welcome.
Hi, good evening.
How are you?
Very good.
So before we start, can you tell a little bit more about yourself and your topic, restaurant sustainability?
See, I've been living in Dubai since 2002-2003, so I've been quite local in this part of the world. Yeah. As you said before, I was working all around the world, including London, Dublin, and cruise ships. So a very long journey here in Dubai, and I came here to work with Gordon Ramsay. I worked for Gordon Ramsay. We opened the first restaurant outside London back in 2001, and I came in 2003. Mm-hmm. And I stayed there for several years. And then, of course, as a fine dining around 2009, if you remember, fine dining was kind of changing perspective in the world. So mostly in dynamic cities like Dubai, fine dining had collapsed a little bit. So for us that we've been working in a Michelin star restaurant and fine dining all our life, we had to reinvent. And that's why I start to work in lounges, because that was the time of the lounges going fantastically well. Of course, always we did the fine dining touch. We opened a wine bar as well, and a speakeasy bar. And so we've been coming to all this journey since until in 2000, 3 years ago, practically, I arrived in Pier Chic. And Pier Chic is an amazing restaurant, and it's a part of one of the most beautiful hotel resort in Dubai, which is Madinah Jumeirah. It's probably in Al-Khazar Hotel. So, yes. You know, you have this beautiful restaurant, and of course, I work for a company that, you know, is very dynamic as well. And we came up all together by willingness to make something extraordinary out of the restaurant. So remove a little bit the idea of a fine dining or elegant dining. Yeah. So we wanted to give something that is a core, something that has got real value, and mostly in a place as Dubai, because Dubai, don't forget, has not a long history country, has been only more than a little 40 years old as a country. So something is changing, and the community is growing very much. So we wanted to do something more for the community of Dubai. In terms to have one of the most celebrated restaurants, to have something that really touch the perspective of each of us. And that's why we decided to do this long journey of a restaurant towards sustainability. And together with Dubai, which is, again, a city that is embracing very much the sustainability itself. Don't forget that this country has been born on a petrol, on the oil. So they use all the resources, all the money, and invested in infrastructure to have something tomorrow for their people.
Yeah, well, so Dubai was built from nothing, actually. It's a desert.
It used to be a desert, yes. Yeah. It used to be a nomad camps. It was very much into pearl. Before the oil was discovered, it was a country where the major trade was pearl. Of course, then we all know the story of the plastic coming into action and the replacing of the pearl. And luckily enough, they found the petrol. So particularly in Dubai, the royal family invested the last reserve of the oil they had into infrastructure and to attract business into Dubai. So it's a very long-term vision that they had to give a future to their people. And that's why we see more and more government effort to remove completely the oil and to go towards the sustainability. And because we're part of that community as well, we were very, very happy to come up as well for our restaurant. And I say, it's not just myself, it's the whole company that I represent that decided to go towards the sustainability. And it's been a 3 years journey, and probably Nowadays, we are maybe on 40 or 30, 40, 50% sustainability. But that's the beauty in sustainability when you work in a restaurant. You know, everybody can start from zero and you can see the progress, 1%, 5%, 10%. It does not really matter. What really matters is your mindset to see this restaurant trying to be. And I say trying to be because it takes long time and sometimes a generation to get 100%.
It's also about changing your behavior as a human being.
Yes, as I said, it's the mindset, you know. And that's why personally for me, it's magic because, you know, when you've been working at the top of restaurant and you've been talking about the chef and the service and the dish and the presentation, yeah. And all these things, I was always missing something, you know. And because I'm a sommelier as well, it happens, you know, by chance that, you know, the day I start to switch into known understanding natural wine or biodynamic or orange movement, at the same time, I start to see the food industry and the restaurant industry with the same eye that I was looking into the wine industry. Yeah. So I combine them together in one restaurant. And, you know, the way you go to work today is just completely different because you're not going just to a restaurant to, you know, make your profit, to welcome your guests, to train your staff and to make sure everything is okay. But you're going there because, you know, you want to...
Oh, we have a little glitch in the live. Let me wait till I hear some audio. But to ensure your words, I think it's not only the business mentality, but also the mentality of the new generations, because they want to contribute as well. So. You have to change your business because the clients demand otherwise. So it's also a real synergy by changing the way we
see. I think the new generation, you know, I see in my son as well, he's only 6 years old. The way he thinks today is completely different. The way I was thinking was I was six, you know, the information those guys are gaining from any kind of platform today, it opens their mind, you know, they're more active. And, you know, for us, you know, when I start to see like 20 years ago, the organic movement, the biodynamic movement was by people talking, you know, we had no platform where we could share information. Today, if you want to know something, platform that means that people know about it, and most of the people of the new generation, you know, as you were saying, they really care. If they really care, they will look for you, they will get information from you the same way we do. So it's amazing for us, you know, from the older generation trying to cope with the generation, but we have one thing in common is those platform that we share and to share information.
Yeah, exactly.
They want and they really know what they're looking for. So that's why community is at the.
Yes, that's a really good point. So if we go along with the sustainability topic, there are a few things which are important to run a sustainable restaurant. Like renewable energy, producing no waste, and capturing and recycling water. How does the restaurant Pier Chic process those boxes?
Okay, as I said before, we had to start from zero. So our restaurant, the most beautiful thing, so our restaurant is on the water. So there is a very long pier, and a pier, there is this beautiful restaurant in the middle of the sea. So the first things we did, and we were the first one to do in Dubai. So that's what,
really?
how fast we are going, you know, thinking we are in Dubai. So, you know, in other parts of the world was done much, much before. But in Dubai, it's new. It was new. It was difficult to take that step. But the first things we did, it, because we are on the water, was to remove any plastic, a single-use plastic from the restaurant. So that is number one action that we did it. So all the straw, all the steerings, the plate, the containers, everything that was a single-use plastic, we had to remove. The most beautiful things is, because we were talking and talking and talking regarding when we start, when we start, when we start, I will never forget our managing director Emma Banks and say, okay, you want to really do? Do from tomorrow. And that was it. You know, that line tomorrow. So in a night, we had to find those suppliers of, you know, cornstarch from Indonesia. And we did it. We just removed. So we were a little bit without a straw and without any plastic in the restaurant. But that was the first things we did. So remove completely the plastic. Mm-hmm. Remove completely, for example, the balloons. We, as I was telling you before, we do lots of celebrations. So people on those celebrations, they bring the balloons. You know, we are in the middle of the water, and if we think those balloons, they can go up into the air, and then, as we know, they come back into the water. And the turtles issue nowadays is that, you know, they do eat because they think it's like a jellyfish. So the major problem of those balloons in the water is probably because they're killing many, many turtles and other fish.
Oh, horrible.
So those was kind of the first things we did it. And then, of course, we started to see, you know, the product. You know, most beautiful things when we're talking about sustainability, and we had to study in some ways for sustainability, you know, to understand. And the long vision was probably trying to understand what are those three pillar P that sits on the sustainability, which is the people, the planet, and the profit. So people, of course, you're doing something for the future generation. That's what we care the more. I have a 6-year-old kids, and I want him to live the same life we did it and the old generation did it in terms of having animals or anything. The second is the planet. We're serving the planet. We want to leave the planet the same way our grandparents they left to us. And of course, the last P that is also very, very important, like the other two P, is the profit. You know, you cannot make a sustainable raw restaurant if it's not profit, because you're going to do a very short term. If you want to do a long term, it needs to be profitable. So looking at this P, of course, we started to see, you know, the product. So we started with 100% of any product that we have in Piersik coming into Dubai. And Dubai is very well known for having 80% of the product coming to Dubai from outside. So it comes only in one port, which is the Jebel Ali port. So talking with the authorities and following the authorities, you know, it's a big problem to have one port that is used for 80% of the total goods coming into a country, and a country like UAE that is expanding. So in this way, since 4, 5, 6, 7 years, many business they've been opening in Dubai that people don't even know. So we start to research in how to get the product locally, because that's what sustainability is. Sustainability is using carbon emission zero, so you don't have to ship or air freight anything. But look for your local producer, give a business to the local producer and get the product from your local producer. That is a base of having a sustainable restaurant. And then we start to dig and we find out that we have so many farms in Dubai.
Really?
Hydroponic. It's crazy. There is a hydroponic farm, and because the water is another major problem for this part of the world. So they're doing those type of farms without the usage of any water or dripping water. So very, very careful in the usage of the water, because as I was saying, in this part of the world, water costs more than petrol. So we start to see, okay, so we have the tomatoes, we have the cooking, we have everything in terms of vegetables. Why should we get from other country? And plus they're all organic and they're all, as I said, in a very, very good quality and doing in those beautiful farms. Also, we start to find out we do oysters here in Dibba. You know, in a restaurant, as a seafood restaurant, we start to, you know, we bring the Pelon, the Tatskaya, the Guillardot, the Pink Oysters. You know, we never knew that we have this beautiful product in Diba. And I don't know if you know the size of the oysters.
Yeah.
So the smallest is like 4, and then it's 3, and then the biggest are number 2 and number 1. But if you get an oyster from Diba Bay that is number 4 or number 3, yeah, it's bigger than the size of number 2 of Guillardot, for example.
Oh.
Because there is so much nutrients in this part of the world, because those water has been never used,
wow,
for farming oysters or any other kind of fish. So the oysters keep on clapping and eating.
They're
eating.
Growing. So
they're growing inside. So even if the size of the old oysters is number 3, for example, but the pulp inside, the actual scallop inside, he has a size number 2. And now they increase in the quantity as well, because now they start to know. We did so much video about, like, there are many restaurants, of course, Pershik. We're not the only one today. And we need to say thank you to other restaurants where they give us information. And,
yeah,
you know, it started with one restaurant, two, now you have 10, 15 restaurants that are trying to be as sustainable as we can. So we found, yeah, the oysters. Then we found the sea bass. You know, there is something strange in this country, because if I may say about this farm, it's called Fish Farm. And a fish, yeah, farm is the biggest fish farm in the world on land. So it's not in the water. It's not done in the water. It's done on land. And in this fish farm, they reproduce the Pacific Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean. So how they do that one is with the oxygen, the temperature, everything they know how to do is all computerized, of course, by an app on your mobile. And practically we can have the sea bass from the Atlantic or the salmon from the Atlantic, all those type of fishes that they grow in the Atlantic, they have been farmed there. And of course, they have the Pacific side. So, you know, we have a beautiful Amachi, for example, that comes from the Pacific. So we start to, of course, we didn't take as it comes, like, okay, they're doing fish. No, we went several times to check the quality, to check the facilities. We were lucky enough one day to cook over there for the Minister of Food Safety that was also checking the premises. So We need to make sure that, you know, the quality is there, and whatever they say on their website, on their communication, is real, because otherwise. So we started in to start to buy, of course, those products, and then of course we went to the chicken, we went to the lamb. So in terms of food, I will say nearly 60-70% of our product comes from locally from Dubai. Of course, as an international restaurant, because of the variety of our restaurant and the creativity of our chef, we still need to bring some product. But that's what I said. If we see in a long term, if today, yeah, we have 60% of local product,
yeah,
you know, we wish that next year we're going to become 70%, yeah, because other little producer will invest in this part of the world and cultivate other products. So we can gain other product to put on our side. Of course, the bread is made in Dubai. We follow strict rules on our sourdoughs.
Nice. And so, do you want to produce your own food in the future?
But as I said, the project for our restaurants, and any restaurant I will work from now on until tomorrow, yeah, the best will always be, yeah, to grow your own crust, to your own vegetables.
Yes.
Something amazing I've seen it in Dubai, and practically there are around the world, because I've seen in New York as well, is this big container. You know, people has bought big containers and they brought just on the backyard of the restaurant, and hydroponically, they're growing Lolo Rosso, lettuce, herbs, micro herbs. So there is a willingness from a restaurateur to have their own product, even for quality, even for message, for sustainability, but even for the diversification of what you can grow,
yes,
you know, and put in the plate. You know, there are many restaurants in UK, in Holland, that they produce 100%, but those are farms. Yeah. You need to have a farm. Those are the most beautiful restaurant, in my opinion. If I go in a restaurant, like I go when I go in Italy, and they produce everything, you know, we call them agriturismo. And it's where I started to work in 1985. In 1985, in Italy, the old farm, you know, they start to get the money from the European community at that time, so they could open a restaurant in the farm. Oh, today, we call it beauty farm or agriturismo, but that was the beginning of a restaurant to get the money from the government, from the European Union, and say, okay, you are a farmer, you're growing and you have animals and everything, you can sell your product. We give you the license. We even invest in your restaurant in order for you to open. And we used to work here, and everything 100% was made in this little farm. That's the most sustainable restaurant, because those farms, they use wastage. Of course, some of those farms today, they have energy made by solar or other sustainable way to make electricity. So this is the aspiration of any sustainable restaurant going, trying to reach that 100%, not only to make the product, but to sustain yourself. It's like same in a biodynamic one, you know, the difference between biodynamic and organic is completely fell apart. You're starting with organic, but then if you want to be 100% self-sustained in your vineyards, you go biodynamic. So you don't need to buy anything, and everything you produce inside your vineyards or in your farm is used to produce the wine and all the other products. Because we have to remember that biodynamic wines is not, they don't grow only wine, but they...
It's the whole chain.
It's the whole idea behind. So this is what we're doing. To answer to your question, yes, we're trying to get as much as we can into the portfolio in trying to be as sustainable as we can using all the products that we need from this country.
Yeah, cool. So a lot of people from my generation, they're willing to pay more for products and services if it's sustainable. How are you making an effort to reach those young people?
But as I said, you know, communication, you know, the most beautiful things today we have on the different type of a platform is to communication. If you go, for example, on the Pierre Chic Instagram, you will see all our stories, and most of our story they will talk about has going to, as I was saying before, going to the farmer. So we have all the videos when we went to Diba for the oysters or to fish farm. So this is what the new generation is looking. Okay, you are sustainable, but the new generation doesn't stop there, start to dig. How are you sustainable? What do you do to be sustainable? You know, they don't stop. They don't believe in everything people say. We were stupid enough when we were young to believe in everything, in our grandparents as well. But the new generation, I believe they know, they're not stopping there. They don't believe, and they love to research. And as I need to be very sure of what you're saying. So we do communication, lots of communication on our platform. But the most beautiful communication we do is in our restaurant. Our staff is very well trained to talk about the sustainability. But one thing I'd like to add when we're talking about sustainable restaurant is that the owner can come to you and say, okay, look, I'd like to open a sustainable restaurant. This is the hardest restaurant you can ever open. And I did open by experience, because a sustainable restaurant cannot be made by an idea. It cannot be. Somebody has an idea, but then you have 80 people working in your restaurant, and believe me, you cannot train on sustainability. No. You need to make them embrace the sustainability. They need to live the sustainability. And you have to be also people to look for. I used to go to a supermarket, for example, and do my shopping and get the bag. But today, I cannot do it anymore. you've been looked, and you need to be that hero to them and to say, I'm not only sustainable in the restaurant, but we are sustainable in our life. Exactly the same things we do in the restaurant, we do in our in my home. I teach to my son as I teach to the waiter or any of the staff in the restaurant. So we let them embrace. You need to have them to embrace. And it's the most beautiful things when one of the waiter came to you and say, oh, look, I stopped going with the bus because of carbon emission. I bought a bike. You know, that's the most beautiful. So, you know, this is the way we look, you know, to run this restaurant is thank you to the old staff and for us to let them embrace, but they need to embrace as well.
So, yeah, you're a role model, and it's really genuine of you that you keeping that role model also outside of the restaurant. It's really cool. And I think it's really nice to teach your kids as well, because they are the future, right?
I see, my son is six. I cannot make any names. I don't want to blame somebody, but there are some products my son will never see until he's 18 years old.
Yeah.
Because we're teaching, we bring into the farm, yeah, we're talking. So most of the supermarket, some of the supermarket product in a jar or something, you know, if I have to do a tomato, I try to buy the tomato, I do the salsa myself.
Plastic, so this is stuff.
Exactly. So, you know, because he knows, and as I said, this new generation is even worse than the millennial generation because they assume, they see everything around them, you know. My son can talk about wine because I always talk about wine in my family. My son, of course, talks about wine and already knows what is biodynamic or what is an orange wine. And if you give a conventional wine, he will ask, it's conventional? Oh, no, we don't drink conventional. Things like this. You need to be very aware that everything you say to them, you need to be very sure that you're saying the right things because they will remind you later. So you need to be very, very, as you say, a model, a role model, trying to really, whatever you preach after you do yourself. Yeah, it's not that we're talking to you about sustainability and after I go in my kitchen, I take my first bottle of water and I drink. I should try to remove as much as I can, even the bottle of water we drink for home consumption, because that's what we try to teach to our staff and to our clients.
How do you train your staff? Do you have this like portfolio needs they need to check in that they really believe and feel the sustainability cause?
See, the way we did it at the beginning, because it happened all at the beginning, trying to explain to them what is sustainability and what's the product. You know, we were lucky enough to compare between products. You know, compare a Seabass line caught Seabass, for example, with a Seabass which comes from a farm. You know, of course, you know. The simplest things I always say to them, you know, if the fish is between 400 and 600 grams or between 900 and a kilo, we'll always be fine because of the size, because that's what the restaurant wants, you know. And we tasted a 400, 600 grams because in my opinion, it's too little to be a fish to be served in a restaurant, but it's even too small for you to eat. When we start to get the product, because some of our sustainable product, we got it from UK, from Cornwall, from the president of the National Lobster Hatchery, Rob Winks, which has in Cornwall an area dedicated for line caught fish, you know. And when we ask it for Seabass, for example, you know, because it's a line caught, because it has to pass through a size of net, so the net will not catch little fish, will catch only between 3, 4, 5, 6 kilo. So when we've been talking about, you know, give life to our staff and making them try the sea bass, then they start to see the difference in texture as well, you know. When we buy, for example, the bluefin tuna from the Mediterranean, yeah, we make sure that whoever sells the bluefin tuna to us, the eggs, because the bluefin tuna comes into the Mediterranean to release the eggs.
Ah, okay.
The most beautiful things is you need to let them release the eggs. That's sustainable, because at least is they give life to life.
Yeah.
When you remove a tuna and a female tuna as well, you're removing a life. So we need to go to those company, which make sure that they have certification that, you know, when was after brought on land, you know, they had no eggs. So with the microchip and with the technology, they have the only fish to type. So then when you start to talking about this difference in texture and life to life and what you're doing to the, people start to realize, you know, people start to think and to make their own idea. That's why I said before, you need to let them embrace, and to embrace them, you just need to talk. So at the beginning, we made a very lots of example of the nature of the fish, of the meat, where they're coming from, you know, even talking about the cow, what's really the big matter of the cow. We want to go out of the cow and the meat.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, because of the mega disaster with the carbon dioxide they produce, you know. So we're giving alternative to cow and to beef, or to have only one. Instead to have 3-4 different type of cat, we selected one cat. You know, we can even have a day off without even using on the menu, things like this. But for the moment, we have only one cat. So and we explain to them, you know, why the cow, why the meat industry is in this way. What does it do, all the cow in this world, and the carbon emission, you know?
Yes. The cats are making the largest ammunition today.
Yeah, more than any plane and cars in the world. So when they start to receive those information, you need to be, I was surprised myself when I started to study, because I didn't know these things a lot, to be honest, you know.
Yeah,
but,
course,
you know, since the biodynamic, you know, I didn't know many things on the 72 different type of elements that can be used in wine, you know. I started probably in 2001, you know. I've been sommelier since 1992, and I never read anything on any books about these things, you know. Even, you know, all the organic, and they still can use a different type of product, you know. And before embracing, you study, trying to make up your mind. We are not here to make you change the mind, you know. We're just giving information. So when we went into the sustainability, because if you want to do really, you need to know what you're talking about, you need to search, you need to study, you need to make up your mind and to have that mindset. We start to see things that I didn't know before. One of those ones was the what's wrong with the cow in this world, you know. I will never imagine.
But you start from scratch, and that's really...
Yeah, that's what we say. Everybody, even if today somebody wants to start to be sustainable, it is nothing bad. Even if you start from zero, it's nothing bad. As far as you start, you know, how long it's going to take you to be 100% is not really the point here. What really matters is that you start the journey, because in the end of the day, it's a journey.
Okay.
I will probably leave the restaurant to another general manager, which will carry on, because the most beautiful things my company did it is not that my company said, okay, Luca, we like your idea, this idea to be sustainable, but we made sure, the company made sure to place in the core value of the company that we as a company is sustainable. And I guess whoever comes after me in the restaurant will continue to be sustainable, because it's in the core value.
Sure,
that's how much
it has to be.
Yeah,
exactly. Now, thanks. We're going to move towards the zero waste society question, especially if food waste is a big thing, because 1/3 of all foods produced in the world is going for a loss. So how do you came up with a zero waste plan for your restaurant? Do you have a plan for such a...
See, of course, you know, the you know, one thing that the restaurants and many restaurants today are doing for zero wastage you know, is to reduce anything that goes on a buffet. So buffet in a restaurant industry should never be there. Not for breakfast, not for lunch, not for dinner, not for brunch. No. Because there should, there will always be a big wastage. Because of course, when you go to, when you advertise a luxurious or lavish buffet, anytime you go, you expect to be as big as it can. So the first things we did, it was to completely remove any kind of sort of a buffet that we had. Of course, another things we did it as a company is instead to pay, for example, for a meal allowance, or instead to pay in a company which bring us the food for the staff during the operation, mm-hmm. we cut the those companies, and we start to utilize 100% of our wastage into staff food. And believe me, when you're working in a restaurant like Pierre Chic, the waste food is not the waste food. It will be the end of the loin of a Welsh lamb. You know, it will be the end of the loin of a black Angus from South Africa. It's the only thing that when you do the, for example, the fillet, you're doing 200 grams.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't look good, you start to cut. What do you do with this one? So what you do with this one, you try to preserve the any cut you have in the restaurant, yeah. used in a different plate. Let's say, for example, the tartare is one example.
Ah, yes.
If I have a beef, a fillet of beef in my menu, is automatically that I will have a tartare. Because with the end part, the part that doesn't look good in the 200 grams, I can use in the tartare. It will be a fantastic tartare. It's not that it's a second class tartare.
So
we had to manage the menu in order to have a plan B for the wastage of any product, you know. The plan C is probably wherever after cannot be given, because we pay, of course, yeah. profitability. Because when you buy 1 kilo of a fillet, you pay 1 kilo. Then the trimmings, it's your wastage. That's why it goes into the tartare. But then we have to make sure that we have a plan C, so that everything can be used out of the product that we buy. Is that, as I said, we remove the subsidy of outside company to provide the staff, the meal for our staff, and we're using the third grade of wastage into the meal staff with a little bit more money, because you need to spend, because you cannot really sustain the old meal, the old staff only with the wastage, because you don't have enough wastage at that point.
Yeah.
If you do the arrangement on the menu with a dish A and dish B of the same product, then you should not really have. So there is still money to be invested for the meal, but at least the staff is very happy, and most of the time tastes as well the same product that we're using for our clients.
It's so also really handy.
This is the most important things.
Yeah, that sounds great.
You need to come up with this idea. As I said, I don't know in the other part of the world, but in Dubai, for example, because of course it's a big hotel resort, Dubai, plenty of hotels, so plenty and plenty of breakfast. That's the major wastage.
Yes.
And because the brunch and the lunch is on buffet, this is what really needs to go out, because, you know, after a certain time and after certain hours, you cannot keep outside, you cannot refrigerate anymore. He needs to go to waste it. And it's a lot, because the buffet needs to always look super full. So you need to order and order. Of course, there are great chefs in the world that can reduce the quantity, make it look nice without going in lots of wastage. I don't have to say nothing, because there are really great chefs around. But if you remove, and like many places today, they are removing because they are embracing sustainability, is one of the major things. And then anything you can do on the menu to have dish A, dish B, and dish C for the same product, in order to use little pieces, as I said,
sounds
in a fine dining.
Good plan. So if it comes to wine, what kind of wines do you serve at the restaurants? Are they all organic or natural wines?
Sì, again, we started with 100% conventional wines, and to be honest, we're not ready in Dubai yet. We don't have, how can I say, lots of biodynamic. We have lots of biodynamic from Burgundy, to be honest. Lots of Burgundian producers anyway are biodynamic, and because is one of the major selling in this part of the world, we are lucky to have lots of producers from Burgundy on biodynamic. But for the rest, we really needed to create a kind of, I don't want to say an association, but we had to make our voice to the supplier. So we're very lucky we work together with other international restaurant, which bring together, we bring together, because you need to do an allocation. He has to be on a special import only for you. So yeah, we're joining team with other sommelier and other restaurants to bring those products. So at the moment, we did a very, very great list of, as I said, organic and biodynamic. The conventional wine still make a good portion between 40-50%. And we start to bring in lots of orange wines. At the moment, but as I said, we don't have a great diversity because of the market is and the growing market. As I said, you know, three, four years ago, you know, people didn't even know. And people coming in this part of the world and sommelier in this part of the world, that they don't have a facility to taste many of those products. Of course, they are a little bit, I don't know if the clients will like, and, you know, different if you are in a major city, London, New York, wherever, you have an abundance of product you can try, so you don't take the extreme and you start soft. So yes, we trying to have as much as biodynamic, organic we can, and replace some of the conventional. But again, conventional, it's a wine that you will always have. There are some very great conventional winemaker, you know, but I guess we need to have some of the product that represents the restaurant coming from biodynamic. And I think we made a great choice to select, for example, New Zealand as a wine country and a wine region, because over 90% of the wine made in New Zealand, they are labeled sustainable. So that is the country for me. And I went last year in New Zealand and I start to realize, yes, those guys are really doing sustainable. Because as I said, I've seen lots of farm where they really recycle and reuse everything, you know, and it's beautiful to see a winery in New Zealand being no monoculture, but diversified their culture in the vineyards and swell, and to have plants and other types of vegetables. You know, using solar, for example, all the wastage is reused in a compost, which after ends up in the vineyard. So, you know, it was an experience amazing for me to go in New Zealand, and I put every idea I saw in New Zealand back to Dubai from a vineyard. So those are the wine we try. Because as I said, you don't have to be 100% winemaker to be, you know, we want to know your story. We want to know what you do to be as sustainable as you can. And the wine we will display on the selection of wine by the glass, man, they will all be with a sustainable idea. As I said, even if it's not fully organic, even if it's not fully biodynamic, it cannot be, but you know what I mean. But as far as there is the willingness of the producer to help the society and the
exactly.
For us is good enough. Then, of course, there are some producers that you love and you just want to display all the range they have.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that sounds wonderful. And I think it fits your story as well, as for the restaurant as well.
See, it fits our story and fits our life, because as I said, you know, we did embrace ourselves. You know, is when we go to work in Pershik. We're super happy to go to work in a place like this one. I have to be honest, you know, as I said, you know, I've been in the restaurant industry since the late 80s, you know, and I worked in many concerts. I worked in a Michelin star restaurant. You know, I had always this beautiful idea when I was walking to a Michelin star restaurant. You know, I was still asking myself, I really work in this place, you know, like, because it's beautiful, you know, to be precise, to do that exact service, you know, to get the knowledge, the method hotel, all the artistic side of the chef, the purity of everything going on in that kitchen, in that restaurant. But believe me, and I really had goosebumps when I entered a Michelin star restaurant. I used to work for those big chef names. But nothing gives me goosebumps like when I walk in Pershik, because I walk in a place that helps the community. As I was saying before, even because we do lots of communication and we do lots of marketing based on our sustainability, you know, it really enriches you in your personal life. So this is the big shift that we had. And we do in everything. We do in the spirits, we do in the wine, we do in the food, in the product. And we try to change the mindset and give knowledge both to our staff and to our clients.
Yeah, you're giving back to the community. I think that's the most rewarding thing that's happened. I mean, yeah, totally. So are you also writing a book? Did I recall that as a...
See, I had to stop. I had to stop. It's not like a book, but you know, it's an ongoing story since many, many years, you know, since I think around 2000. It's because, as you know, for us that we are in the wine industry, we always need so many books.
Yeah, I know.
To read, you know, the wine of Burgundy or the wine of Bordeaux. And so our bookshelf is full of wine books, you know, and I always had this dream since I saw the Sotheby's encyclopedia, you know, trying to do something as Sotheby's encyclopedia, where you have the whole world in one book. It's very difficult because the time you finish something and you start something else, you have to re-update.
It's a big job.
I have to be honest, and I have to be honest with you. See, since now is kind of 2 years that I left it alone, probably because, you know, I did this big book and this big encyclopedia, and now I'm in love with biodynamic, and there was nothing on biodynamic, organic, orange, or Georgian wine. So, you know, now I have this beauty to keep on writing.
Exactly.
So it's a big encyclopedia. I mostly use for training myself, first one, because being a general manager, sometimes we leave a little bit the wine industry on one side. So it's beautiful that you gain knowledge from one side, but sometimes we forget the ex knowledge that we have. So it's used mostly for myself as well and for the staff to train ourselves and to go forward. And as we say, you know, knowledge is the key of the future, you know. And you know, even if I will never publicize the book, that doesn't really care for me, you know. What you really care is that you use it and, you know, you're willing to use
so much
bright and
you
to follow our passion.
Yeah, exactly. So we're almost finished for today. My last question will be, can we follow you and Pershik on social media? And
yes, of course. On mostly on Facebook, on Instagram is Pershik Dubai. I will really suggest to go on Instagram. As I said before, we have all these videos, all the suppliers and farmers here in Dubai that we've been traveling to see their product, and to all the international people outside Dubai. Probably now that we are opening the door to the visitor on the 7th of July, you know, is another reason to come to Dubai.
Great.
To see something that you could experience only like in 6, 7, 8 different parts of the world, but only in one country, to have such a variety of those different type of farm in water, on land, beautiful real farm, It's an experience. It will be a next idea generation of traveling to this part of the world, probably to see as we combine together the beauty of the technology and the innovation towards a common goal that is the sustainability. And I want to really thank you, Zelda, for talking about this topic. It's something that we don't hear much a lot around, but it's always nice to make that question and to listen and to know regarding what everybody in this difficult time is still trying to do and to stay sustainable, you know? Yeah,
exactly. And I have to be honest, a lot of people are talking about sustainability, but the picture is so much bigger than most people think. So I really love to talk about it, and I should definitely come to your restaurant one day.
See, it's difficult to explain. Really difficult to explain sustainability. You know, we're trying to explain in so many different ways. That's why the 3P always works: profit, people, planet, and profit.
Exactly.
Because it tells you, but then you have to talk about the people. How many things can you do for the people? How many things we can do for the planet? That's why I said, you know, it doesn't matter if somebody knows a zero today. If you start and you embrace this idea, tomorrow you will know 1%, and then 2%, and 3%. And your lifetime, you may reach 100%. But even if you don't reach 100%, it doesn't really matter, because you've been living a very wonderful life.
Exactly. I love that vision. I truly do. So, Luca, thank you. I will stop the recording now, and I will post this on my socials. I will send you the video. And for the people at home, thanks for watching. And
thank you. Thank you for having me.